Good evening, everybody. I'm Tony Joyce, Associate Dean of Marketing and Communications at London Business School. And this evening is a real treat, actually, for all marketing professionals, or anyone who has marketing professionals working for them, or who works with marketing professionals, actually. Does that cover pretty much everybody everybody in the room?
Oh, that's good.
Your neighbour's a marketing professional is good enough. It's good enough. You just squeeze through there. And actually, just to tell you what a treat it is, we were just talking to Paddy and Thomas before they embark on what can only be described as a global launch tour. But they're doing almost each of those events, just one of them by themselves. So this is actually a rare sighting to have them both in the same room. So we're very privileged. My pleasure to introduce Paddy and Thomas. So Paddy Barwise, many of you know, Emeritus Professor of Management and Marketing here at London Business School, MA at Oxford and MSc and PhD from London. Paddy is an expert on many, many areas of marketing, and I'm not going to dive into all of those because we'll never get them on stage, but among many others, brands, broadcasting policy. His research interests include customer-focused strategy and execution. He's written widely on the concept of meaningful differentiation. You may all have read that book. If you haven't, you all should have read that book. Those books, I should say, Paddy. And it's never too late. When he's not at London Business School, Paddy is visiting senior fellow at the London School of Economics, an advisory board member of two successful startups, Research Now and Verve, which focuses on, not as in Verve Clico, but as in Verve, online brand communication, and a former chairman of Which. Paddy is also an ex-practitioner, as we call them here, of marketing with IBM. I hope that's okay, Paddy, ex-practitioner.
Is that right? Yeah. It's true, then, isn't it?
With IBM, Austin Hall Group, and Graphic Systems International. Thomas is a former partner at McKinsey. Thomas conducts marketing leadership research, including actually the world's largest study with over 68,000 executive assessments on what makes an impactful CMO. So that's of interest to all of us. Thomas has consulted for many of the world's leading companies, including over two dozen within the Fortune 500. Thomas began his career as a marketing practitioner at Kimberly-Clark, working on the Kleenex brand prior to joining McKinsey. As a dean of the firm's of McKinsey's highest rating internal program, and that's quite some claim if you've seen some of their internal programs, he's trained over 1,000 McKinsey leaders on driving change without authority, something that's close to our hearts at London Business School sometimes also. He also shaped McKinsey's highly successful global client relationship strategy efforts. Thomas also serves as leadership dean of the CMO Fellowship Program, which is a joint venture between McKinsey and the Marketing Academy to prepare CMOs for CEO roles. Thomas also writes for a number of publications and not least for his own blog, thomasbarta.com. Just a little plug for your blog there. Thomas holds a master's in business from Cologne University, a master's in clinical organizational psychology from INSEAD, but most importantly of all, has an MBA from London Business School. So on that note, I will hand over Thomas and Paddy. Thank you for joining
us.
Thank
you very much.
So we've called this Leadership Below the CEO, What Drives Senior Marketers' Business Impact and Career Success. So this is about increasing the impact and career success of marketers. And that obviously includes the impact of advertising and the other things that are paid for out of the marketing budget. But it also includes marketers' role in helping companies become more customer focused and their impact on business performance through that wider role, because it's customers' overall experience of the brand and the company that drives short-term performance and brand equity, and through brand equity, long-term business performance. So what do we know about this? And when I say no, I mean as an academic, really know. Well, first of all, we've known for nearly 30 years that the marketing concept works. We were, of course, teaching it for decades before we actually knew it worked. Then the Marketing Science Institute funded a program of research. And yes, it turns out what we were telling you all was true. Companies really do succeed by profitably, keyword profitably, meeting customer needs better than the competition. So that's tick there. We know the marketing concept works. Interestingly, we now also know that despite what a lot of marketers believe, CEOs and other top executives do understand the value of brand equity. That research was published in a top journal 2 years ago. And it's by Nada Tavasoli. And is Rajesh here? Rajesh Chandy and another colleague in the States. And the reason we know that top executives understand the value of brand equity is that they are willing to be paid less, other things being equal, to work for a company with strong brands. Because they identify with the company, and because if you work on a strong brand, it's good for your personal reputation and your career prospects. Okay? So don't tell me that they're purely short-termist and they don't understand the value of brand equity. They are short-termist, because and there are good reasons why they care about quarterly earnings and all that, but they do understand the value of brand equity. Finally, and crucially, based on research published only last year, we now know that having a CMO in the top team and an influential marketing department does help drive business performance, short-term and long-term. So what's the problem? Every CEO wants the company to be more customer-focused. Marketers are the linchpin for making that happen. Surely the marketer's role in the company should be exalted, and the top team should always come to them whenever it makes any major business decision which directly or indirectly impacts customers, which is almost every major business decision. In reality, it doesn't work like that. In reality, most marketers have only limited business impact and career success, less satisfying careers than other functions on average. In other words, marketing in the sense of customer focus is important, but marketers very often are not. Now, that's the issue which we were interested in investigating, and the research, which I'll summarise shortly, was about how can we increase the influence of marketers in order to help companies to be more customer-focused, in order to drive long-term and short-term business performance. And the book came out only last month, called The 12 Powers of a Marketing Leader, How to Succeed by Building Customer and Company Value. Now, obviously, the research is described in some detail in the book, but in summary, we collected and analysed self-assessments from over 1,200 senior marketers from around the world. We also analysed 360-degree data on another 7,400 marketing and non-marketing executives. In other words, this is not just about what senior marketers said themselves about their behaviours and their business impact and career success. It's also about what marketers' bosses and peers and subordinates said about them, and the comparison between those data and comparable 360-degree data about other functional leaders in sales, finance, operations, and so on. Now, we have this puzzle, okay, that marketing is important, marketers very often not important. Why? We think there are three fundamental reasons, and they're reasons which are not going to go away. Every marketer has to bridge three fundamental gaps, and the first of those gaps is the trust gap. If, as a marketer, you think about the work you've done in the last week, how much of that was about the future? Future sales, future campaigns, future products? 50%, 70%, maybe 100%. Marketing is mostly about the future. And so when you, as a marketer, stand next to someone from operations or finance, much of what you say will sound less reliable, because it is. As a marketer, you will always have a trust gap for that reason. Gap number two, a power gap. Imagine your company has the best customer experience in the market, the best products, the best distribution and service support, the best value for money. How many people in your company will have been involved in creating that market-leading customer experience? Many. In fact, almost everyone who works for the company, directly or indirectly. And how many of those people report to marketing? Few. To create, most of the people you need to create a great customer experience don't report to marketing. If they want to, they can pretty much ignore you. You have to win their support. As a marketer, you will always have a power gap. Gap number three, of course, is the skills gap, the growing skills gap. Now, there was a time when, as a marketer, a senior marketer, you were the expert, and the people in your team could come to you for detailed advice on what they were doing. That time has gone away, okay? There's just too much, and it's changing too fast. And half of what the 23-year-olds didn't even exist when the CMO was 23. Okay, so you can't know it all. You have to be a leader of leaders. You have to work through other people. And that's a leadership challenge. You have to know enough to be able to do that. But you have this challenge, the skills gap. And that's not going to go away. If anything, it's going to get worse. And that's the problem. That's why we think we have this paradox that it is in companies' interest to have influential marketers, but in most companies, marketers are not very influential because of the trust gap, the power gap, and the skills gap. So what's the answer?
So before we talk about the answer, let me ask you a question, please. Who is working in marketing or is planning to do so? Just curious. Okay, so there will be good news, right? So brace yourself. I mean, when you heard this up to now, it's like, I have to say, I was a marketer, I mean, for many years, and the sentence, marketing important, marketers aren't, it sounds so true from what I have experienced, but it's also frustrating, right? So, but we have good news. We have real good news. So the question is indeed, what is the answer? Now, coming back to the research, and Paddy, you will excuse me that I will do this. Of course, I have the license of, as a non-academic, to do this slightly more casual than perhaps it would be proper to do in an academic way. But I'd say we've built a neural network model to figure out how everything is kind of connected, and we try to understand what is explaining the business impact of a marketer, which is kind of like the million-dollar question. So here's what we found: gender. No. And I think that's real good news, right? So you can screw up as a female marketer as easily as a male marketer. It makes no difference, right? So gender is not the issue. It's not a predictor. It does not explain success. B2B versus B2C? No, doesn't. And that's surprising because there are a lot of B2B marketers who would say, yeah, but it's way harder where I work. Well, yeah, but it's also really hard in the consumer goods company. Someone said to me, look, where I work, nobody understands marketing, right? That's really difficult. Well, I guess coming to join a consumer goods company, everybody understands marketing. That's really difficult, right? Everybody has a perspective. So it's actually not making a difference, surprisingly. Personality. Well, here's more good news. It's not that relevant. It's under 5%. So we what we used is the Big Five, our personality model, which is quite validated and really big model to figure out, you know, does it make any difference? It doesn't. Or in other words, you cannot blame your parents, right? It's like this, right? It's not that. Functional marketing skills, well, there we go. That's basically the stuff we're teaching, learning in marketing. We're learning at every single marketing conference we're going to, in all the marketing books and blogs. That's what we talk about. And when it comes to explaining success, it's about 15%, which, you know, it's not that much compared to how much fuss we make about it. Now, of course, it's really important, right? It's your entry ticket and you have to do marketing, but it's actually not really the predictor of your success. So it was quite shocking. I was at a digital marketing conference this morning where everything was about, everybody in the room was really proud about their knowledge, right? And when we talked about this, everybody was like, and then they were talking about their cut budgets, right? So knowledge alone doesn't do it. So what else? The company. Well, finally, someone to blame. So actually 25% is the company, the boss. you know, the kind of like incentive system, he has all set up in the right place. So it does actually make a difference. And we're recommending towards the end of the book, Paddy, that if you are in the wrong company, find a better one. Yeah. So it actually makes a difference. But there we are. What's left? It is 55% is indeed leadership skills. And it's not because that's how we designed the study, but it is indeed, we had a lot of functional skills in there. We had a lot of personality things done, validated by psychologists. So we really tried hard and it came out like this. So that's the good news. If you think about it, it's really good news because it's not personality. So therefore you can somehow, you know, get your head around the stuff. And as you see in a minute, it is actually quite doable. So that's the big finding we have. It's not about doing marketing. It's about how you lead marketing. That drives the success of marketers. And that's a big message I think we're trying to kind of get across. And it's it will take a little while for it to trickle through, but I think there is something powerful here. So now, you could say leadership skills, that's a big, you know, that's a big box, right? I'm sure you've all read leadership books and there are the different schools of leadership. And so here's what we found. Of course, when you talk about leadership, leading teams is quite important, right? And a lot of the, let's say, historic leadership theory has been around leading subordinates, right? How you run great organizations, great teams, you know, people under you, motivating them, right? And then there are different schools from punishment to, you know, making everybody happy. So how you lead teams. And that's still very important. Then came the 70s and self became the center, right? Well, how about me, right? What about me as a leader? How is it authentic what I'm doing, right? And how does my style fit the organization? So there's a lot of that. And it does play a role. So it came out as one of the factors. But guess what really made a huge difference in addition to what we just had? It's those other people, right? And think about it, you know, in today's matrix organizations, this starts to make a lot of sense. Number one is your boss doesn't know it all, right? So the question as a marketer is, are you able to mobilize up, right? Can you shape the agenda? Can you close the trust gap that Paddy spoke about, right? It's really important. And it's a completely different skill set from leading teams, right? It's very different. And can you lead peers? You know, we showed the cat picture, right? Paddy talked about the power gap, right? So you got to find ways to mobilize people that don't report to you. And we found that besides leading team and subs, which still does matter, leading boss and peers is actually a big driver of success. And that's where a lot of marketers can actually step up and be even more successful. And then also it will help their careers and, of course, the business impact. So we got tips for you, and then now it becomes really casual, so apologies. So there's the academic version of this is in the book, right? So this is pretty hands-on stuff. So four tips. Tip number one, as a marketer, it's important to tackle big issues. Tackle issues that are really seen as important and crucial in the organization. I recently spoke to a marketer, and he complained very badly that his advertising budget for a telecoms company was cut by 30% this year. And when I had a discussion with the CEO later on, he said, well, I actually believe the future is in retention. And if you cut advertising, it's actually not really so bad. Yeah? They haven't talked. And what happened is this. So typically, marketers are really good at understanding customer needs. They're really good at, and we all marketers are good at this, right? We have a feeling for the market. We kind of like what people want, and we know when the experience is good or not. We have that, right? But are we equally good at understanding what's key in the company, what's crucial? You know, if you talk to CEO today, what are the three priorities they talk about, right? What is it? And I'll tell you what, it's surprising, and I work a lot with marketers, it's surprising how many marketers find that difficult. Right? I mean, think about your own, if you are working in marketing, your own situation, and what would you put in the left bubble, right? But what would you put into the right one? And here comes the saying, you want that overlap. Because when you get into this zone that we call the V zone, the value creation zone, this is when you start to have power. This is when people listen to you. This is when you get to sit at the table, right? When you're equally relevant for both sides. And that's a very important message to marketers that, you know, of course you've got to look at customers. You've got to understand their needs. But actually, you know, there's a big other customer group there and you've got to understand them really well as well and try to see how you can create that overlap. That's tip number one. Tip number two, side with the revenue camp. So everybody like Paddy, who has a very good finance background, will immediately agree. But it's a very practical consideration. When you talk to a CEO today, so what is typically on their mind? What are the things that they worry about seriously? What's high? If you're a CEO, what's high? Cost, yes, okay. Slight hint in the background. Revenue, right? And then typically it's the organization. Now, here's the thing. If you as a marketer are not seen as revenue, if you're not in a revenue game, what are you then? And if you're somehow smart as a CEO, what do you do with cost? Yeah, you reduce it, right? And that's the issue many marketers see themselves in. The people at the top of the organization cannot immediately explain, right, the marketing's contribution to revenue. So if you are a marketer, the call we would have is think about how you can explain and associate yourself with revenue generation. And if you can't do it yourself, I'm sure there will be someone in finance who will be happy to help you. At least explain what you can explain and explain what you can't explain. But that is essential if you want to really make a difference as a marketer, is to be in that revenue camp, as we call it. Number three is, this is getting more difficult now, become a leader of leaders. Now, here's a real challenge for everybody who is in marketing, and I include myself. You grow up as an expert, right? Because you do some specialized stuff that other people kind of don't understand. Now you grow, right, and you're kind of in that mindset that you kind of have answers, and Paddy related to this earlier. Now, of course, there's a point when this is useless because you need people to grow under you to be as smart as you are. And actually, in today's organizations, where it's about mobilizing the boss and the peers, right, that they do the same. It's very hard for us to do this. So becoming a leader of leaders, and here's a Napoleon picture to support our point, is difficult for marketers. It's difficult to let go of the control, right, of everything. But that's the only hope you have, because you cannot change the organization on your own, right? You cannot shape the agenda of your boss on your own. You cannot mobilize colleagues on your own. You need people who stand up and do this. So we have a trick for you. You could actually establish a rule in the marketing team. And that rule is called forgiveness and not permission. Can you establish a rule in your team that says, look, what we're going to do is this. I want you to try. And you will screw up at times. Okay, then say sorry and we'll learn. Right? But it's better to do this than asking for permission every single time. The only change in your leadership is this. Instead of controlling, you have to invest as much time in creating common goals. Because this only works if people are chasing the same thing. Right? And if I meet a marketing team today and I tell people, take a white sheet of paper, write down what is the number one and the number two priority of your group, you will see a lot of very different answers. And it's a moving target. Yeah? It's true for every, it's not just in marketing. But that is the job. You change the time from controlling people into actually helping them understand what the big goal is and let them go out and try. Tip number four comes into this. Now, this picture symbolizes a job that you have to do a lot as a marketer, which is go out and talk to all the species around and understand what's actually really going on. And you cannot do this by email, right? So in marketing, getting out of the office and getting in front of all the people you need to mobilize is absolutely essential. And still, a lot of marketers, when we look at their timesheets, there's, you know, as 45% of time is in front of a computer sending email. That's not how you make any change happen, right? You just fill in boxes. So here is how you can do this. Number one is hit the head and the heart, as we call it. As a leader, your job is to give hope to people, as it's what Napoleon said, right? A leader is a dealer in hope. So you need a story. You need a story for what you're doing. The question is, if you are a marketer today, or if you want to go into marketing, or you work with marketers, what is the story that you tell? How do you give people hope? Do you send around segmentation documents and launch plans? Or is there any story that you tell? What's the story? I mean, London Business got a great story when you acquired this building over there, right? This was a great story for quite a long time. I mean, this was a story behind it, right? It wasn't just raise some money for a building. There was a whole story behind. And this, it resonated. At least it generated lots of cash. Now, here's an example for someone who did this. This is Jim Farley, the former CMO of Ford. He's now running Ford in Europe. And he took over the marketing helm at Ford when they were basically bankrupt. Some of you may remember that. It was close to the 2000s, right, when basically everything went down the drain and the American automotive companies really had a hard time. And guess what happened in marketing? People cut budgets and everything, right? So, and Jim said, you know, okay, how am I going to tackle this? So I need to appeal to the emotional core, right, of my people in the company. So rather than sending around presentation, he went around and said, look, the way this works is like this. The blue oval, the Ford oval, this is the reason why people buy cars. And why is it? Because they remember and they associate us with pride, with adventures, with stories that they had, you know, even when they were young, right? And now what they're associating us is, you know, financial difficulties. We have to bring back those memories because that's when people were going to buy our cars again. The story worked really well, and he was behind one of the most fascinating marketing turnarounds in the industry. And he would tell you today that storytelling is perhaps your most important skill as a marketer. That's what Jim Farley actually said in an interview. Okay, one more tip, start a movement. In today's organization, it's very hard to play stuff up and hope for the CEO to decide and then everybody does it, right? I mean, I don't know in your companies, but I have rarely seen companies where it works this way. Right? People vote with their feet and all these things. So the only chance you have as a marketer to get something going is to start a movement. Now, I'm sure you've all started movements in the past, but I guess let me give you the first hint how you start a movement. The trick will always be to get on the dance floor first, right? If you want to start a movement. In marketing, we call these pilots, right? Or at least show the thing. Now, if you want to get people to dance, don't talk about dancing, but just get on the stage and actually do it. You know, if you work in customer retention, you get your spreadsheet out, run a few campaigns, and show that the stuff works. You got to do this. You got to show people how it works. Now, here's the question to you. Once you've shown to people how it works and it kind of looks good, what's the next thing you got to do to start a movement? The next thing. That's a crucial next thing. You've all been on parties and started a dance for no.
Get followers.
That's get followers. And you actually need just a few. Find very few followers, people who actually go with you, where the energy is. Yeah? Sios hair care shampoo would not exist if the marketing director at the time, Tina Müller, hadn't agreed to launch it in Moscow, which was the only country, I mean, it was Russia, but Moscow really was the market. The only country manager who said, okay, I'm going to give it a try. And everybody said, don't go there, it's too small, you know, just. And she said, no, let's do it, right? And guess what happened, right? I mean, it was a success. And, you know, a few days later, everybody turned around and wanted to be part of the action. And this is how you start a movement in companies. You need to find a very few people who actually come and, you know, play. And it may not be the ones you look for. Maybe there are completely different people you haven't thought of. But the trick is, always as a marketer, once you've shown it, is to find out who are the two or the three to four people who would be happy to follow you. And that's typically then what happens if you create a success, right? Everybody comes around. So this is, I think, a very quick summary of some of the tips for you. But I guess, Paddy, is a probably good time to summarize us.
Yes. So first, the marketing concept works. Companies do succeed by profitably meeting customer needs better than the competition. And our summary of that is the value creation zone, the V zone, meeting customer needs and company needs, and using innovation and creativity to maximize that overlap. The second piece of good news, we now know that influential marketing does increase business performance. However, marketers have only limited impact and influence within companies because of these three gaps, the trust gap, the power gap, and the skills gap. So that's the problem. The solution is what Thomas has been taking you through, that some of it is the conventional leadership solution. All leadership books are about managing your subordinates. Good leadership books are also about mobilizing yourself. But what the data show, which makes perfect sense in today's world, is at least as important for marketers, is to mobilize their bosses, understand the boss's agenda, mobilize the boss, and mobilize peers. So next steps. Go on the website and do both of these things. The first is a leadership quiz, which is asking you to guess the results. Now, one problem with a book like this is most of the things we're recommending, if you're a good marketing leader, you're already doing quite a few of them, and they all sound fairly commonsensical. However, because of the research, we now know which of them matter most and which of them matter less. So go on the website, do the leadership quiz, and you will find it is may be more difficult than you think to guess the relative importance of the drivers of business impact and the drivers of career success among within our sample of senior marketers. So this is just to make you, if you like, take it more seriously. It sounds obvious. It's not actually that obvious once you say a lot of this is about priorities. Secondly, take the leadership profile test, which is to see where you stand as a marketer or marketing leader, which are your relative strengths and weaknesses. So those are free self-assessment tools which are on the website. Meanwhile, some questions you can sort of whistle on the way home and think about. How can you expand the V-zone in your business? How can you increase the overlap between customer needs and the company needs? And how well do you understand the CEO's agenda? Because a lot of marketers don't understand the CEO's agenda that well. How strongly are you associated with revenue? Are you demonstrating that you're in the revenue camp, not the cost camp? Are you a leader of leaders? Do your people ask for permission or do they ask for forgiveness? How close to that situation of getting them all aligned on the same objectives and then delegating to them? How close to that are you? What's your compelling change story? One of the things about that is, you know, there's a lot of talk in marketing about storytelling, and, you know, you don't have to be Roald Dahl. Okay, these stories can be very, very simple. The Jim Farley story at Ford was a very simple story about bringing a sense of pride and adventure back to the logo. So obviously, that's not the only thing he did, but the story which sort of engages people at an emotional level, it does not have to be a complicated story. It can be very simple. And finally, as well as being willing to lead from the front yourself, how can you then find the first followers? And the tip there is go where the energy is. It might be the guy in Moscow, but if he's the one who's got the energy to try it out, go with that. And then you're getting at least some evidence which will make other people follow.
And there's one more thing. The biggest weapon you have as a marketer is your inspiration. Your boss can say no, your colleagues can say no, even your team can say no, right? They can just all say no to whatever you're doing. But people are really attracted by others who inspire them. That sounds really grand, right? Inspire people. Ooh. How do you inspire people? How's it work? Rhetoric courses? Better dress? Perfume? I mean, what's the logic, right? How do you do this? It's actually reasonably simple. All leaders that get credited for being very inspirational actually are inspired themselves. There's something in them that they truly believe in. It's either their knowledge, it's either their dream they have, it's either that they really love people, it's either that they love coming to work. There are many, many things that could make that inspiration. The question is, what is it for you? And do you know it? And if you don't, there's a very simple trick. You asked 10 people to write on a blank sheet of paper, anonymously, how did I inspire you in the past? And you collect it and have a look. And typically you'll find amazing things. And then once you figure out what it is, all you do is way more of that thing. And that's when people start to see the fire in your eyes. Crucial in marketing. So we're going to wrap up with a quote that we believe summarizes quite nicely the challenge that you have, because you are an entrepreneur as a marketer, and we believe build your own dreams or someone else will hire you to build theirs, and we hope you will. Thank you very much.
Any questions? Sure. Can I have one mic at the front? This is so everyone can hear your question. Can you say who you are as well?
Yeah, sure. Bernard O'Brien from Deloitte. Thank you very much for a very interesting presentation. Quite an open question. I'd like you to, with all your research, ignoring the four gentlemen, tell us who you think has been a great marketer, who you think has been a great marketing company, and why.
Well, I can give you, I mean, this is a very traditional answer, but I think that for many, many years, Procter & Gamble was a very, very good marketing company. It then lost it during the 1990s when everyone fell in love with the internet and said, you know, packaged goods was kind of 20th century and boring. And then A.G. Lafley came in and turned the company round by creating a reality of, you know, the customer is king, meaning the consumer, okay? Because when Procter says customer, they mean the trade, but the consumer is king. And one of the things he did to make that a sort of emotional reality was to say that, of course, like all sophisticated consumer goods companies, there was plenty of research, but the senior people in the company never met consumers. And, you know, if you think that's a problem in the UK or the US, think about Mexico. You know, the world of the senior Procter manager in Mexico and the world of the average Mexican housewife are very different. And the solution to that isn't even to hire an anthropologist, although that is a good thing to do. You have to spend time with her, in her home, with her family, and don't talk about laundry. Okay, talk about the things that matter to her in her life. So I would say, I mean, it's a very obvious answer in a sense, but Procter and A.G. Lafley, who then took over in the year 2000 and got them back on the basics, that would be my example. Thomas, you have...
I think this was a great summary, and I believe I think it's hard to single out individuals because marketing is also sometimes a place where the top people are actually not that visible to the outside world. But I'd say the best marketing leaders, they have a few things in common. They always had a view on what they're actually trying to achieve, and it was not doing marketing. It was a broader vision, a broader, bigger idea they had. And I think they relentlessly showed a lot of tenacity over a longer period of time to actually push an idea through. And there are many examples like this, but I'd say the people who really are on a mission and don't give up after 6 months, I think those are the ones I believe are great marketers.
Other questions? We have a mic here.
I think they jumped.
And again, say who you are.
Mm-hmm. David Lunto, BGL. So a question, I guess, a very fascinating study. Thank you both. Yeah. Does anything change inside some of the new digital companies or the newer digital companies in terms of the lessons we should take? So thinking particularly about people who, frankly, take a relatively cavalier view of rules, people like Uber, as well as people that maybe take a relatively cavalier view of economics, like Jeff Bezos and Amazon, about how to drive customer satisfaction without really focusing on margins at all.
Do you want to answer that for me?
Let me understand. So when you say what's changing, do you mean what's changing in the way marketing is being done? Or I'm just trying to get off the ground of your question.
Sure. So is there a difference inside some of those digital leading companies compared to, say, I recognize a lot of what you say about FMCG and some of the more traditional, some of the more traditional businesses, B2B and B2C, but... Yeah. Is there a different set of rules or just a changed set of rules or emphasis inside digital businesses, please?
So the digital business I work with, the one difference is, first of all, that marketing isn't seen as a cool thing. Right? So there is actually, I find marketers that work in digital, specific technology companies, find it even harder sometimes to make that because it feels like it's typically driven by either a really big idea of someone, right, or it's very technology, engineering, programming driven, and marketers are currently a bit of an add-on to this. But I think that rule is again changing, like in many industries that have started somewhere with something really new. Where, I mean, think about many inventions in the past, right? When you had the first cars, marketing wasn't really one of their challenges. But as these companies mature, they're all picking up marketing skills. So I see this curve every single time. And if you now talk about people that work at Amazon, talk at Google, they're all of a sudden hiring marketers to actually start segmentation and starting. So I think they are at a different stage of their development. But I think the challenges when they're maturing become reasonably similar to challenges of mature companies.
They certainly worry about brand.
Yeah.
Obviously, analytics tend to play a very big role. Yeah. I mean, Amazon being sort of a case in point. I don't really know what's going on inside Uber, so I can't comment on Uber. Amazon, as far as I can see, is actually in many ways a very conventional marketing company. The interesting thing is this view of you know, postponing the profit and postponing the profit. So it's and the ability to carry the financial markets with you, you know, is it's kind of quite impressive. But he's obviously gone for, you know, to build up the revenue, and he's done that by I would argue being very, very customer focused actually. So to me, Amazon is unconventional as a finance company, but actually quite conventional as obviously a very analytics driven mm-hmm. marketing company. And it's a brilliant brand name, by the way. I mean, I remember winding people up during the when we had a thing called the Future Media Research Program, and saying, because everyone associated it with books, and they say Amazon is not the name of a bookshop, it's the name of a very, very large river in South America. And of course people got very angry with me, and I say what I think this is suggesting is that he is trying to build a massive channel, and many things will flow through that channel, and so it has come to pass. So he's taken a very long-term view, but no, that's a marketing company to me. Great question. Can we have a mic here, please?
Hi, I'm Jane Luckin. I'm a B2B marketer. In the course of your research, did you come across any insights into how marketers should work with sales teams and sales leaders?
What do you find particularly challenging?
Well, we tend to be very different personalities and motivated in quite different ways, which is a driver of success on both sides anyway. Mm. But they often own the numbers, so when the deal comes through... Yeah. It's, you know, it's kind of their win. And it all, I suppose, it comes back to your analytics. How can you trace the leads generated through to the final sale?
Hmm. I think you've answered the question.
Yeah, okay. That's the only way. Yes. You've really got to get your system sorted.
Well, but it's also about relationships. I mean, I think that you've seen, we put a lot of emphasis, but it really comes out of the data, at, you know, building relationships with non-marketing people, particularly finance, actually, but operations and sales and so on, you know, that's really, really important. And, you know, everyone talks about the importance of getting outside the silos. It's a bit of a cliche. And like most cliches, it's true. Okay, so I'm afraid that's what you have to do. Understand their perspective. And, you know, there are too many marketing people who really don't understand the most basic finance concepts. No one who's graduated from this place would fit in this category, but you know, I mean, marketers are very proud if they can spell NPV, knowing what it stands for. So you've just got to put the time in, but really understand their perspective. Obviously, salespeople do tend to be a little bit short-term oriented. I started life at IBM, and there was a whole genre of jokes about IBM salespeople, most of which are not suitable for a family occasion like this, but there is a culture difference. But, you know, assume they aren't stupid, and assume they, you know, they still want to be around next year, and understand where they're coming from.
Actually, we have an example in a book, just reminded me, where you were saying this. I did work with a B2B marketer, and to raise the game, what he did, it may not work for you, but he actually got involved in pricing. Because this is something the sales team found, of course, important, but also difficult. And this was a territory that we carved out in the end as one of the areas where he and the team could build a lot of credibility. And that was very relevant at the very top.
So. But I thought your answer was a very good answer to your question. Okay? You just got to work really hard at what are the metrics. And again, with your non-marketing colleagues, they kind of understand what in advertising we would call the account planning process. In other words, a sort of disciplined, evidence-based way of saying, where are we now? Why are we here? Where could we be? How could we get there? Are we getting there? And then using the metrics in a very systematic way. And they understand that you can't prove everything. They know there's a difference between things which are very short-term and easy to prove, and things which are maybe more brand oriented and are harder to prove. So the metrics are, you know, hope and metrics are your key things. Inspiration. Question here, I think.
How much time do you need for creativity, and how much time do you need for skills? I know there is many other things, but let's just to focus in two variables. You need to understand you need to make people from finance to fall in love for your ideas. But at the same time, I think you need to be able to be aware of the technologies that can really deliver this return on investment. So I would like to have your comments, please.
So, I mean, if I understand it correctly, what you're saying is the challenge you are raising is how you split in a way that the time of your attention, right? I mean, you only have so many hours a day, right? To, on one hand, you know, get the functional skills right, which are, of course, extremely important, but then also, you know, keep the creativity, which is still an important part of marketing, right? And how do you try those? Plus, I guess, there's leadership skills, which we added to the mix, right, to make it a little bit more complicated now. And what's quite interesting, if you think about your position as a leader, there will be times when you will be on the dance floor, right? When you'll be doing the work, right? When you'll be doing the skills and, you know, all the things that you do in marketing. But there are times when it's important to step onto the balcony, right, and see what's actually currently going on and what do you need and what's important. And what we see right now is that a lot of marketers, because of the skills challenge, are basically staying entirely on the dance floor, because there's so much to look out for, right? That it's getting harder and harder to go exactly on that balcony and saying, well, hang on, where's my mix? So I think the question in a way to you is, if you think about your situation, if you had to say to be successful, right, what's my current mix? I mean, is it creative enough? Do I have enough skills? Do I have enough leadership skills? And it's a very individual answer, but right, where, how you do this. But what we are asking marketers to do is to go on the balcony and actually have that look. And I tell you, there are a lot of marketers who haven't been on the balcony for quite a while because it's overwhelming right now what happens in your job. So that's the question, right? If you're on the balcony, what is the mix that you believe is right for you?
And then you've got something similar for your team skills as well. So given your specific strategy, you know, what's the mix of creative, analytical and leadership skills you want in the people below you? I think the question you're raising is possibly the biggest current challenge in marketing, because you could spend all of your time reading about, you know, all the D stuff, which changes every week, and trying to keep up with all this digital stuff, you still wouldn't be on top of it. So you need to know enough to know that the people below the people below you are hiring the right 23-year-olds. You need to be able to have the conversation where the people below you are not rushing, chasing every new shiny object, and you can have an intelligent dialogue about which are the ones which really will make a difference, and, you know, basically who's bullshitting you and so on. And that's pretty difficult. But, you know, our observation is that if anything, because of this pressure to try and keep up to date with all the latest digital stuff, most marketers are ignoring the bigger business issues that are important to the company and are ignoring the sorts of leadership issues we're talking about. So it's a very difficult balance, but we think most senior marketers are actually struggling to find enough time to stay focused on the big business issues and the leadership and organizational issues. But we're not saying it's easy. It's very, very difficult.
Hello, I'm Mark Law, LBS Alumni Book Club. So we're interested in books, so thanks very much for that. I was particularly struck by your comments around Start a Movement, which is around activism. I think there's some really powerful stuff in this, and you gave a tip on trying to find people who dig what you do. Do you have any other tips for being an effective activist in this sort of area?
There's an interesting insight in our study when we asked marketers, do you see yourself as a role model? This was the lowest number of all we got, right? The highest number was openness, and the lowest number was role model. So I think to be an activist, there needs to be some confidence that what you're doing is actually the right thing and you believe in what you're doing. So that's the answer I would have as a marketer. You are a different individual in that organization. It will feel strange at times, But you got to almost say, look, you know, what I'm doing is the right thing, and customer focus is the right thing, and I am a role model, and I want you to behave like I do. So that's a role modeling piece that I would add to the activism, which I think is crucial. Paddy?
And we also talk a lot about persistence as well. I mean, walking the halls and then walking the halls again and, you know, just keeping at it. And it's similar to what we know about entrepreneurs, that obviously the venture capitalists look for two things, a great business idea and a great management team. But if they have to choose, they'd probably pick the management team, okay? Because it's not just, you know, the skills and do these people get on well together, but, you know, to innovate, you need to be very persistent and bloody-minded and keep going. And if we're talking about customer-focused innovation and being activists, then, you know, sheer sticking power is also part of it. And repetition, actually, you know, if you've got an inspiring story and so on, you probably need to keep repeating it quite a lot in order to make it happen. So there's being first onto the floor, there's going where the energy is and getting some followers, but then there's evangelizing and keeping doing it, but also listening to people. So one of the stories we have in the book is you know, of someone who came up with a great idea and everyone said it can't work. And he then spent time with them saying, okay, tell me about the problem, let's work it through. Most of the problems can be worked through, but it does take time and persistence.
Is there any evidence that pivoting is a key skill as well, being able, like the venture capital guys,
yes,
like the entrepreneurs, to switch?
Having mental flexibility and so on. Yes, I mean, I think that you need to be stubborn and not dogmatic, okay, which is...
okay, so
it is a very fine line, yes. I am firm, you know, he is bloody-minded, you know, that sort of thing. We had a question there as well. Okay, yes.
Thank you. My name is Niels Hammerlink. I have a background in consumer intelligence, and we talked about data just a little bit before. I was very interested in understanding if your research had uncovered a bit more insights around kind of the structure and ownership of data. I've done this for a while. It's done from finance, marketing. Where sits the data, the marketing analytics, especially if you have organizations nowadays that, you know, you have customer success, you have everywhere else. Like, how do you drive it? Who owns it and where does it sit?
Well, I think that the customer analytics should be in marketing. Maybe I'm biased. There is a challenge of how do you combine it with traditional market research, because they are complementary to each other. Mm. And interestingly, the Market Research Society's research on what have been the growth areas in insight in the last 5-6 years, obviously the big one has been analytics, but the second biggest one has been qualitative research, because they complement each other. And you need qual research. You know, there's a bit of a myth that analytics is sort of hypothesis-free, that you know you torture the data and then surprising things come out. That's not the way it actually works. It's much more sort of conjecture-driven and ideas-driven. And so you need qual to drive the ideas, and you need qual possibly to interpret the ideas, and then you need sort of analytics. So I see those as being very, very close to each other in a well-functioning organisation, and therefore I would put it in marketing. The one place, in my view, it definitely shouldn't be is technology, is IT, okay? Because obviously then the tech will dominate.
Finance.
Possibly finance, spoken through gritted teeth, if I might say so. Yeah. I can't possibly imagine what triggered that comment. Okay, take a deep breath. Next question's here, yes. Spoken with feeling, if I might say.
Hi there. Fabulous presentation. Can't wait to read the book. Thank you so much. So my name's Heidi Taylor, and I'm an independent marketing consultant focusing on B2B and professional services. My question has to do with, do you think we are teaching our young marketers in the right manner, and are we even teaching our marketing leaders in the right way? The context for this, I, not too long ago, worked for a very, very large global company, 300 marketers. I was the only MBA.
Mm. Well, professional services, as an ex-McKinsey partner, would you like to comment on...
Well, I have a view. No, but look, I mean, I think the schools, right, that marketers go through, and this could be on the academic side, even on the academic side, but also on the training side. Of course, it's built along the same model that marketing is currently built, which is very doing marketing focused. It's very skills focused. It's very like, okay, marketing strategy, segmentation. And those are things that are quite important. But I don't think there is a lot, if any, preparation for the fact that you will be in a very odd role in reality, right? Because you are a very slightly different person. We haven't talked about personality details, although it doesn't matter in success, but marketers are different, right? There are sometimes the eros in a logos world, right? The emotional connected people that are working with people in finance who want to see results. And I haven't seen a lot of preparation in marketing for this role and how to survive and how to work. I mean, when we did the research, we were trying to look at previous research, which there wasn't any. And trust me, and Paddy was quite rigorous and challenging me on that. There's very little on this. And some of the courses we do with the Marketing Academy and McKinsey, these are some of the first courses that prepare marketers for a leadership role, which is quite unique. So to answer your question, I think no. I think we, with the insights that we are now starting to generate, we have to shift the training a little bit, right? We can't take the skills away, but we have to prepare people better for their very difficult roles, for them to be way more successful.
It's quite interesting about leadership, actually, because if you go to the leadership section of a business bookshop, or you go, if you look at leadership on Amazon, then what you find is it's all about managing subordinates. Okay, so it's about Jack Welch, it's about Napoleon and the Pope and so on. There are lots of things you can learn from those people, okay? But I think that something which we and other business schools don't do, because everyone is obsessed with chief executives, okay? What we're not doing is, and nor is anybody else, is actually of those graduates who go into industry as opposed to investment banking or consulting, the great majority of them will be senior middle managers in large organizations. And the only things they will have been taught about leadership, either by us or by the books, is how to manage your subordinates, which is really important. But it's one-dimensional leadership, not three-dimensional leadership. And so I think there is actually a great gap, which is potentially for us, in terms of the book, a good thing, because, you know, what the data said is that you need three-dimensional leadership unless you're the chief executive. And so, I'm actually rather bullish about the prospects of this book, because I think we've... Now, I'm also expecting enormous defensiveness from the leadership experts, because they don't want sort of marketing people blundering in and actually saying you're only dealing with half the problem. But they are dealing with only slightly less than half the problem. Now, professional services are really difficult for marketers, okay? Because the rainmakers get to the top, and there are reasons for that. I think there's something. If you think of the city law firms, I do expert witness work from time to time. Work with city law firms, and what you want in a city law firm is you want people who are really good lawyers and are really good at handling clients. Now, recruiting really good lawyers is easy. They're the ones with the best law degrees from the best law schools. People with client skills, that's more difficult, and so. You need to, even as a marketer without much influence, I mean, the professional services, I would think marketers have probably less influence than any other type of business, the sort of marketing people. The sort of thing you can do is a version of what A.G. Laffley did. Now, of course, the professionals are spending time with clients all the time, so you don't have this sort of Mexican housewife problem. However, are they really listening? And so, if you can interview some big clients using video and say, what would you say are Jack's strengths and, what are the things he might want to reflect on? And Jack is probably not a very humble person if he's a, senior partner in a professional service company. Then the data will become quite hard to deny. He'll say, Jack is great at this, this, and this. However, he really didn't listen to me when I, etc. And you know, with limited power, you can chip away at it, but it's a tough gig, I have to say. Now, are you worried about time, Tony, yet, or are we...
Okay,
we've got another... Me lose my voice? How long have we known each other? My voice is
unusable. You can't rely on that.
We have one there and one there. Okay. So we have,
and the lady here in the front.
Oh, we've got one in the front here as well. Okay. No, I'll keep talking.
No.
Hello, both. Thank you for a really insightful evening. I'm Ishreen Bradley from Bizaz. Good to see you again, Paddy.
Thank you.
So... I love the four-dimensional model of leadership, and I'm curious, what does it look like to be a great leader of your boss?
That's one of the big sections of the book. Okay? And there are 12 powers, and three of them are about that. One of them is, and so work with the best people is you know, is not a huge explainer, but working on the big issues... is a big one, and providing, showing demonstrable returns, okay, is the other one. So it's, I mean, I think what you were talking about in terms of the metrics and so on, and it's very strong. So, you know, this is, we want you to fly forth like eagles, soar like eagles when you come out of this room. Actually, when you come out of this room, you get a drink, but when you come out of the drink, soar like eagles, because this is meant to be very empowering. Managing your boss is really important, and there are things you can do. Work on the issues that matter to the boss. Demonstrate that you are what you're doing is evidence-based and has been thought through, and you know you can do it. It's in the evidence. There was another question there, and one at the back, and then I think we had one here, and then I think we will. It is then drinkies time.
I'll try not to take too much time. It's Barnaby Voss from Google Cloud.
Yes.
Earlier, you sort of, one of the key sort of charts was that being in the right company is important.
Yes.
Do you have a sort of framework or kind of quick sort of top tips for how to identify that or things to watch out for?
It's easier to identify the wrong company.
So I'd say like this. To start with, if... So there are four or five dimensions. There are five dimensions in total, but the simple ones are completely misaligned goals and so much infight between departments that you simply can't break it, right? I mean, there are situations when it's like this. There are places where you simply don't fit in, right? You just don't share the values. You just think the place is wrong for me. And I think the third one, maybe just mention this one, if you do have a boss that believes... customers are kind of important, but not really. I think you're wasting your time.
So literally the last paragraph of the book says your plan A should be, I'm going to make this company more customer focused. Plan B is look for another job. Okay, if the CEO really doesn't get it, look for another job. Because customer focus really should start at the top. Okay, the chief brand manager should be the chief executive. I think we had one right at the back, and then we got one there, and then we really will stop. But we'll circulate. Over there? Yes.
Thank you. Hi, I'm a middle manager in a large organization. Chris Murray at Smith & Nephew. So I guess in my experience in this company and in my previous middle management role, you see, marketing is a very transitional role. So people get promoted into marketing. Mm-hmm. They'll do the shiny thing for a little while. Mm. And then, you know, imbued with that success, they'll move on to other roles. So you never really generate that capability in that function, or you're constantly refreshing it. Mm. Is there any tips you'd recommend from an organizational point of view about how you build that capability and retain that capability? Is it a question about seniority in that marketing function, or how do you get people to stick in that role so they can really become engaged and be that voice of the customer?
Do you want to answer?
So what we're now saying may sound really counterintuitive. What we found is that people rotating in and out of marketing is actually a good thing for the organization as a whole, because one of the biggest challenges marketers have is sometimes not being able to talk the language of the organizations at different levels. And you have this, a great example is people are recruited, you know, from consumer goods into telecoms, or nowadays perhaps into some tech companies, right? Because they supposedly have these fantastic skills, but then they're coming into a place where they don't speak the language. And there's a lot of failed careers because of that. And we can actually prove that product knowledge is a huge driver of career success in marketing. So I think on one hand, I think it's actually a good thing if marketers rotate in and out of marketing, and we would actually strongly support that. Now, that isn't the question you've asked, because you asked the question, so how as a marketing team you then keep the capabilities. The question I would have, and Paddy, I'd love to get your thoughts there as well, is, you know, what are those capabilities? What are the core capabilities that you definitely want to have? And my advice would be to isolate what are the 1, 2, or 3 core capabilities you need and actually start to predict those. Because typically what we found is that marketing teams talk a lot about capabilities, but in fact, depending on the organization, there are actually a few things that really, really matter. And it could be pricing, it could be some type of positioning work, and it's very different by organization. And I think reducing the number of capabilities you're very protective about, that's, I think, is the summary of what I was saying, is one of the ways you can do that.
And marketers invest less in training than probably anybody else.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so, I mean, invest in your people. One of the things that came out of the data was the importance of knowing your stuff. And knowing your stuff about customers and competitors is quite a big driver of marketers' business impact. Interestingly, really knowing your stuff about the products and the supply side, okay, what's expensive, what's cheap, what's difficult, what's easy, is a big predictor of career success for marketers. Okay, so, you know, really knowing your stuff. It sounds obvious, but you need to sort of hold your people's feet to the fire to make sure they really know their stuff and they're not just sort of bluffing. And that means actually spending a little bit of time outside marketing, you know, close to the salespeople. A lot of the classic FMCG companies start people in sales before they come into marketing. And, you know, there are reasons for that. But also, you know, if you have some people spending a bit of time close to the product development people, close to operations people, and so on, so that you're getting this sort of good horizontal communication, but then more investment in training as well. Final question.
Hi, I'm Nancy Sloan. I'm an LBS Sloan Fellow and Head of International On Purpose, which is a social enterprise. Mm-hmm. And I'd be keen to know, as part of your research, were there any particular insights for organizations trying to operate in the social sector where they're trying to put purpose either on par with profit or even ahead of profit in terms of, you know, creating a movement? Do they need to focus on something even more, like, you know, let's say, the storytelling, to get the message across versus a kind of a classic private sector organization?
Well, they do typically have a better story to tell. And so you should exploit that to the full. Is that, you know, there are things which are more difficult in the non-profit sector. Typically, you can't pay as much and so on. On the other hand, I think increasingly with the younger generations, actually believing in what you're doing, you know, is very important. As Tony said, I was chairman of Which for 6 years. And, you know, Which is a charity fully funded by commercial operations, but, you know, we ran it as one organization. And so everyone, whether they're commercial or actually doing some of the pure charity side, you know, believed in the mission, and it was a single mission. The fascinating thing is what's happened with Pullman at Unilever. So one man, enormous multinational, one man, primarily one man, has got that organization showing that sort of extra bottom line, you know, you can do. And some of it's, I'm being, you know, an Oxonian, I'm sort of semi-skeptical about the ethical consumer. I think that, you know, the ethical consumer in the market can be overstated as far as the majority of the market. You have organizations like the Co-op, which maybe have people who put too much emphasis on that. But in terms of recruiting people and getting the best graduates, then being an organization that you know, has a purpose is a huge advantage. Thomas?
I think it's a great summary. It's perfect.
Why don't we go and have a drink at this point? Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.